We begin with two presidents who want the world to know that they are on the same page. Today, the leaders of China and Russia promised each other deeper ties with, quote, no limits. Vladimir Putin met with Xi Jinping in Beijing in a choreographed show of solidarity just hours before the opening ceremonies of the Winter Olympics. And they sent a message to the West as well, that they are unified in their opposition to NATO expansion.
The highest profile guest of the Winter Olympics touching down in Beijing. Russian President Vladimir Putin is in China to attend the opening ceremony. But before that, a much awaited reunion with his Chinese counterpart Xi Jinping. The opening day of the Winter Olympics is the start of spring, and on this special day we meet. We believe this new spring meeting will inject more vitality into China-Russia relations. I would like to thank you for inviting me to the opening ceremony of the Beijing Olympic Winter Games. We know that this is a heavy task, but we believe that our Chinese friends have, as always, made excellent preparations for this large-scale event. But the new Russia-China partnership goes way beyond the Winter Olympics. China added its support for Russia over the tensions with Ukraine. Both leaders highlighted their aligning views on global security while accusing the US and NATO of a Cold War ideological approach to defense policy. A show of unity and mutual backing amid fears in the West that Moscow is preparing for military action against Ukraine.
Earlier, I spoke with journalist Fabian Kretschmer in Beijing, and I asked him about China's stance in the Ukraine conflict.
Yeah, it's quite ambivalent. So China's official stance is that they support a peaceful solution in the Ukraine conflict. However, today's statement showed very clearly that the solidarity of Beijing is with Moscow, and how far that will go, however, we're not sure. I mean, we know that Beijing doesn't want any further military escalation during the Winter Games because that's their stage of presenting themselves and they don't want any interference. However, if, for example, Russia would invade Ukraine, then it would also be tactical knowledge for China itself, because they have their issue on their own. They have a conflict with Taiwan, and even though the matters are slightly different and separate, there is some parallels. And if China, for example, sees that the West will not oppose strongly a possible invasion in Ukraine, then maybe they could also feel more confident in containing Taiwan.
That was Fabian Kretschmer there, reporting from Beijing. Well, my first guest is Mary Kaldor. She's a professor of global governance and director of the conflict research program at the London School of Economics. She is joining me tonight from Brighton in the UK. Professor, it's good to see you again. I think we have got the technical glitches solved now. Let's talk about what we're seeing here. Russia secured China's backing for its NATO critical policy today. Does that make an invasion of Ukraine more or less likely?
I'm not sure whether it will make any difference. I think the problem is that it does seem rather likely, because there's no way that the West can give in to the demand that Ukraine doesn't have the sovereign right to join NATO, even if we think that's not a good idea. Now they've built up all these troops on the border. It's very difficult to see how they're going to get out of this without some kind of military action.
And do you think that's what's going to happen?
I've no idea. As I said, it's not actually Putin's style. He tends to go for destabilizing actions, for social media actions, for special forces. It's not the kind of thing that he does. And what's more, I think any war will be very protracted and bloody. The Ukrainians will try to defend their country in a very serious way. So I'm not sure. I mean, maybe some other action, maybe some greater an attempt to annex Donbass, for example, or some other type of action will happen. But it's something we should be really worried about, and we should be really aware that in a way the European security system has broken down, and that means we need to really rethink the European security system.
Well, when you say it's broken down, I mean, is it broken down, or does Vladimir Putin want us to think that it's breaking down?
Well, it obviously has broken down if it hasn't been sufficient to prevent an invasion. I do think, although I do think NATO expansion is a pretext, I think that Vladimir Putin is really interested in fomenting tension abroad to shore up his position at home. I think aggressive behavior abroad is very much linked to repression at home. He doesn't want Ukraine to become a democracy that Russians could emulate. He needs the fear of external threats. So I think those are the reasons he's doing all this. But at the same time, I think, you know, when the Cold War ended, it was a great tragedy that Europe was not demilitarized and that NATO continued to exist and indeed expanded. I'm absolutely sure this is just an excuse for Putin, but nevertheless, we should be giving him the excuses he needs.
Yeah, let me pick up on the situation for Putin inside Russia. You wrote in your blog today that this Ukraine crisis is not about Ukraine, but rather about stabilizing Putin's regime in Russia. Do you think that approach is working for
him? Well, I think it's one of those approaches that, you know, he has a regime that's basically kleptocratic, criminalized, and very authoritarian. And he's constantly nervous of domestic protests, domestic pressure, the kinds of things we've seen in both Ukraine and Belarus and Armenia and other places. He's very nervous of what they call the color revolutions. And making it clear that democracy doesn't work, keeping up a permanent external tension, is the way he tries to manage these dangers.
Professor, I've got about a minute left. Let me ask you, we're seeing 3,000 U.S. soldiers head for Eastern Europe to NATO allies there. Is that the right way to counter Putin's approach?
I think that we need to start talking about an alternative security system. It's very good there's diplomacy. It's good there are proposals for arms control and disarmament. But we really need to raise the human rights issues. And that's, I think, what we've failed to do. We need a security system that is based on the principles of the Helsinki Agreement of 1975, which brought together peace and human rights. Given that there's a link between what happens at home and what happens abroad, it's incredibly important to help create space for change within Russia. In the end, this aggressive policy will only be stopped by anti-war pressures from inside Russia. And we need to think about, what do we do to support human rights, to support activism inside Russia? I think, and we should be thinking about a sort of Helsinki 2.0, which would include both peace items, both cooperation on things like the pandemic or climate change, terribly important, and also human rights. And I think we should think particularly about human rights in eastern Ukraine and Crimea. Russia says it's for the human rights of Russia. It should be for the human rights of everybody.
Professor Mary Kaldor joining us tonight. Professor, we appreciate your time and your valuable insights in this affair. Thank you.
Thank you.